The Terra Nova expedition lives in infamy. Beginning in 1910, Britain was trying to demonstrate its imperial glory by attempting to be at the forefront of exploration and discovery. Led by Robert Falcon Scott, they were thought to have an excellent chance at reaching the South Pole. Of course, it's well known that Scott and the four men who accompanied him all perished on the final push to the pole. However, there are more to these men than the final endeavours that we all know. The individuals themselves have lives and achievements outside of this mission. So today we look beyond that and take a look at one of these very special men who accompanied Scott, Lawrence Oates. Lawrence Oates was born in Putney, London, on March 17, 1880. He was the eldest son of a wealthy family, landed gentry even, that had owned land in the country since the early 16th century. But you could also claim that Lawrence had adventure in his blood. His father, William Oates, was a member of the Royal Geographical Society, which has made him well acquainted with many explorers and naturalists of the time. Additionally, his father and uncle, Frank Oates, had spent years exploring Africa until William settled and Frank went on to become a mountaineer. Being a child of gentry, he received an enviable education, eventually studying at Eton College. However, young Oates did not care much for the stuffy social conventions and expectations that came with his family name. He didn't try and hide his disdain either. He would deliberately choose shabby clothes as to other himself from those around him. And at a time where social skills were of the utmost importance, he opted out. He often missed out on parties and social functions, and therefore developed a reputation as quiet, thoughtful, and notably awkward around the opposite sex. However, he wasn't disliked. He was known for his dry wit and his matter-of-fact attitude, which many appreciated. This would be considered social suicide for many members of high society. But Oates had plans, a way of proving himself on skill and merit, away from the etiquette and expectations of Britain. Oates only remained at Eton for 2 years before dropping out, heading straight to military crammar school. These schools were designed to push candidates through the system to more efficiently put them in the military, prime and ready to work. In 1898, at only 18 years old, Oates was placed in the 3rd Battalion West Yorkshire Regiment, 2 years later being transferred to the 6th Inniskilling Dragoons as a junior officer. But his real chance to shine was when he was transferred to the Inniskilling Dragoons Cavalry. He was promoted to 2nd Lieutenant. This placement had him serving in the Second Boer War, where he took part in many operations, leading people in Cape Colony and Orange River County, with notable distinction and bravery. In March of 1901, he was involved in a skirmish that resulted in him being shot in the thigh. However, he didn't surrender, claiming that he'd come to fight. The wound resulted in his leg being shortened by an inch, and for the rest of his life, he'd walk with a limp. He was serving again by 1902, this time as a lieutenant. During this time, his skill and bravery became even more evident, getting noticed by Lord Kitchener, who wrote often of him in his dispatches back to England. All of this exemplifies Oates very well. He wasn't a man who wanted to climb a social ladder, as tradition may demand. He was a man who wanted to prove himself from his own skill and actions. In 1906, he was promoted to captain, serving in India, Ireland, and Egypt. During his military career, he acquired the lifelong nickname Titus after the 17th century priest. But in 1908, whilst stationed in Mahau, India, he was showing signs of becoming weary with his career, remarking that he found Mahau a dull little place. Not even foxhounds that he had imported from Britain eased his boredom. But during this time, he would read something that changed his life. He read that Captain Robert Falcon Scott was again recruiting for an Arctic expedition. Oates wasted little time in applying. He was a great candidate to Scott. Not only could he help finance the endeavour, but he had a secondary skill. During his time serving in the cavalry, Oates had become a very good horseman. Not only that, but it went back to his childhood years, where he'd spend a lot of time playing polo or just tending to the horses on his own accord. Captain Scott had already decided that horses would play an integral role in his quest for the pole. The British used them to haul sledges, unlike the Norwegian opponents who used dogs. Being somewhat of an expert, Oates wanted to play an active role in choosing the ponies that they'd bring with them to haul sledges. However, Scott went ahead and brought the Siberian ponies without consulting Oates. Oates became surprisingly angry at this. When analysing the ponies, he noted that they were too old and not hardy enough for the Arctic. He even went as far as proclaiming that Scott had been cheated by the Russians. However, the conflict between these two men was brief, and Oates did his utmost best to look after the horses and the dogs that they'd brought with them. Scott and Oates became fast friends and had a mutual respect for each other. In a letter to Oates's mother, Scott had this to say: "I really don't know what our party of sailor and scientific man would do without him. Everything depends on the success of these animals, and your son kindly took charge of them." Lawrence Oates was indeed well liked in the crew. His matter-of-fact attitude and determination in the face of hardship made him a valued team member. Scott would call him the cheery old pessimist. But other nicknames, like Titus, and particularly the soldier, were what stuck. On the 9th of January 1912, Oates was chosen to join Scott's small polar party. He, Henry Bowers, Edward Wilson, and Edgar Evans would join Scott in the final push for the pole. But this bold quest would ultimately fail. But very quickly, Oates began to struggle. The war wound on his thigh had begun to flare up again, and his feet were intensely frostbitten. But he said absolutely nothing to the other men. It was 2 months before he had to reveal the extent of his injuries. His skin had become an unhealthy yellow, and walking was an absolute agony. Edgar Evans died on the 17th of February after an accident from falling down a crevasse. Oates felt even more sorrow. His death highlighted the importance of speed and efficiency, and he began to feel like dead weight. He tried his hardest to be productive and helpful, but he knew he was slowing the team down. Captain Scott himself wrote in his journals on the 5th of March, 1912, that the poor soldier was nearly done. By the 15th of March, he told the remaining men to leave him in his sleeping bag that night and continue without him. They refused. But Oates had already committed to the idea that he was a liability, and at worst he may cost the whole team their lives. He took matters into his own hands, and on the 17th of March, his 32nd birthday, they awoke to a blizzard. They'd have to wait before they continued their trek to the pole. Lawrence stood up, left his boots at his bed, and went to the entrance of the tent, and he uttered the words that Britons define as an act of bravery and self-sacrifice. "I am just stepping outside. I may be some time."